what would happen, and it's still happening to this day, is a subject would enter my life. I might meet someone, I might read something. And then suddenly, out of wherever, information about that subject would be coming at me from all angles. And from about the kind of mid to late, from a 95, 96, child abuse, Satanism, and all the things connected with it, secret societies big time, because those three things absolutely go together, that information started to come to me. And it was a trickle to start with, and then it just became a flood. And I went to the United States in 1996 to just go out around the country talking and speaking. Or speaking to nobody, but my goodness me, didn't I pick some information at that time. I'll give you an example of the synchronicity of what was happening. Just before I went out to America in 96, I got a package through the post. It was from someone in this country. And they said, look, here's a book. Thought you might find it very interesting. And the book was called Transformation of America, by a lady called Kathy O'Brien and a partner, Mark Phillips, but mostly Kathy O'Brien, in terms of her experiences, which are fantastic. The first place I was speaking in the United States, the first place I ever spoke on these subjects in the United States, was in Colorado, in Denver. So I get off the plane at the infamous Denver airport, of course, it's another story, and I go to this event, and it's a multi-speaker event, and the speakers had little tables where they could put their books or, you know, leaflets or whatever, and the organizers had given me one, and they'd given someone next to me one, and that someone was Kathy O'Brien, whose book I just bloody read, man. Right? And I didn't know from Adam before. We became great friends, and still are today, obviously from a distance, and Mark Phillips. And her story was one that I was to hear from person after person after person all over the world. She was taken as a very young child into a infamous government military mind control project called MK Ultra. And it was called MK Ultra, Mind Control Ultra, because they were using the German spelling of control because of the Nazis that were brought out of Germany at the end of the war through something called Project Paperclip to set up the mind control operation in the United States, and also set up NASA, actually, if you look at the evidence in my books. And very soon, I became very, very clued up because of the people I was meeting who'd experienced it in mind control and the connection from mind control into pedophilia and Satanism. The form of mind control was called trauma-based mind control, and that is you traumatize little kids to the point where it's called dissociation. And basically, in the simplest terms, you are creating the young child's mind in a form like a honeycomb, compartmentalized. And so they call these compartments alters, in other words, altered reality. And they have a front alter, which is the personality which people think is the person when they interact with them. Then they have the back alters, which are programmed, quote, personalities. They're actually mind control programs. And things like, we've seen with, you know, assassins programmed to shoot, you know, people and all that stuff. That's all part of this. Sirhan Sirhan, who killed Bobby Kennedy, was a classic MK Ultra type mind controlled assassin. And massive part of creating these traumas, which break the mind up into these self-contained compartments, which are where the mind is basically, it's compartmentalizing and shutting off that part of the mind that experienced the trauma. And in doing so, it creates these compartments, which can then be turned into, quote, personalities. Do you know, Rich, I sat with a lady called Vera Diamond, who was a therapist who worked in Harley Street, with, you know, very famous street for that sort of stuff and medical stuff in London. But her her business, if you like, her practice was destroyed the moment she started talking about Satanism and paedophilia and mind control among the rich and famous. But I became a very good friend of Vera Diamond. And I sat in her front room and I saw in, 20 minutes, half an hour, something like 8-9 different personalities come out of one girl. One of them was a child. A baby, and then some were absolutely evil. Some were all different kinds of personalities. Whatever, and what Vera was doing, she gleaned through her various techniques the trigger codes to access that personality. So you have the front altar, that's the person we all know. But then when you give the trigger, that front altar goes to the back, and one of the back altars comes forward. Now this person's a totally different personality. And I saw that just by Vera giving these trigger, they could be words, they could be phrases, whatever. And all through this, paedophilia was fundamental, because paedophilia and Satanism and torturing kids was, like I say, a major way that they created these altars. Now, I've got The Biggest Secret in front of me, and you know, I'm just going to read you a passage, because I want people to understand the scale of horror that these kids go through and are going through now as I speak around the world. Kathy O'Brien has a daughter called Kelly, who I've met a number of times. Lovely, lovely girl, but my God, what happened to that kid? And Kathy O'Brien, one of the key people who traumatized her, well, among them, the key person was Father George Bush, a notorious paedophile and torturer and killer of children, as I've said all over America, and I've said in my books. And the there was Dick Cheney. He was brutal to Kathy O'Brien when she was older. Bill Clinton was involved in it. All these people are all connected. And Father George Bush delighted, and probably still delights, in causing maximum trauma to kids. And in this passage, she's describing how Father George Bush was using cattle prongs on Kelly, just a little kid, to create the trauma and the pain. And this is what she says in Transformation of America. And this is what is happening to children in staggering numbers all over the world. She says Kelly became violently physically ill after her induction into George Bush's neighborhood. That's what he called it. And from every sexual encounter she had with him thereafter, she ran 104 to 106 degree temperatures, vomited, and endured immobilizing headaches for an average of 3 days, which is consistent with high voltage trauma. These were the only telltale evidences aside from the scarring burns left on her skin. Kelly forbade me to comfort her, pitifully complaining that her head hurt too bad even to move. And she didn't move for hours on end. Kelly often complained of severe kidney pain, and her rectum usually bled for a day or two after Bush sexually abused her. My own mind control victimization rendered me unable to help to protect her. Seeing my child in such horrible condition drove my own wedge of insanity deeper, perpetuating my total inability to affect her needs until our rescue by Mark Phillips in 1988. Kelly's bleeding rectum was one of the physical indicators of George Bush's paedophile perversions. I have overheard him speak blatantly of his sexual abuse of her on many occasions. He used this and threats to her life to pull my strings and control me. The psychological ramifications of being raped by a paedophile president are mind-shattering enough. But reportedly, Bush further reinforced his traumas to Kelly's mind with sophisticated NASA electronic and mind drug mind control devices. Bush also instilled, and this is what all these kids get. Bush also instilled the "who you're gonna call and I'll be watching you" binds on Kelly, further reinforcing her sense of helplessness. The systematic tortures and traumas I enjoyed of a child now seem trite in comparison to the brutal physical and psychological devastation that George Bush inflicted upon my daughter. So this is the world that suddenly opened to me to see what was happening behind the scenes. And incidentally, the person who came to fetch Kathy O'Brien from her Satanist pedophile father to go into the mind control MK Ultra program was a man called Gerald Ford, who was the House of Representatives member for Michigan, where Kathy lived. So when you look at the fact that the CIA and the National Security Agency know everything that goes on around these people, not least presidents. So they knew what Bush is. It's well known among the insiders. And what did the CIA do? They named their headquarters after him.
Yeah, he was a former director, wasn't he?
In Virginia. And of course, what also was coming out in the 90s, and you've had interviews, Rich, about this on the show, was the Lawrence King pedophile ring. Lawrence King was a major Republican who was such a big Republican, he sang the national anthem at the Republican conventions in, I think, 1984 and 1988. And he was exposed by a guy called John W. DeCamp, a state senator in Nebraska, for running a pedophile ring, supplying children to the rich and famous and politicians. And one of the people that some of the kids mentioned coming to Nebraska to take part was Father George Bush.
All true. Every word of it. I want to say that because, you know, I don't like interrupting. I'm treating this tonight as a kind of a lecture because you've been researching this for 25 years. There will be some of our audience horrified to hear you name the former president of the United States, the former head of the CIA, and name him as a pedophile. But you did in The Biggest Secret in 1998. As David just said there, Lawrence E. King was the most powerful black man in America and was proven to be taking children from Boys Town Orphanage, flying them around the country, not only supplying them for these sadistic, disgusting parties that David has described, but also using children to set people up, set their enemies up, get children in uncompromising positions with their enemies, take photographs, and then blackmail them. These are some of the scummiest people on the planet. All of this is absolutely 100% true. I'm just saying that because I know there are going to be people listening on some of the other radio stations we're broadcasting on, and they're going to be saying, Jesus, will he ever interrupt him and criticise what David is saying? The fact is, David said this in 1998. It's published. There's never been a whisper from anybody associated with the Bush family anywhere. Go ahead.
So what happened then, Rich, is I was 3 months in America, the kind of maximum I could get out there on a visa, 90 days, is it?
That's right, 90 days, yeah.
And I met so many people. I actually, before I came home, I was actually talking at mind control conferences where people who were that call themselves survivors of mind control and pedophilia and Satanism were talking and giving their experiences. So I put together an enormous catalogue of information documentation in that period, and I came home. And what had been happening in this country is I was starting to meet people in this synchronistic way I talked about. And a name that kept coming up when I was talking to people who said they'd been abused and they'd been involved in satanic ritual was Ted Heath, Prime Minister of Britain from, was it 1970, 74, the man who took us into the European Union, as it's now called. And what I do, Rich, is people give me information, and I don't just blurt it out and say, this is what's going on. I put it on the back burner, as I call it, and I let it simmer, and I see what else comes. And eventually there comes a point where you've got so much information pointing to the same thing and the same people from so many different sources. You meet that point where you think, I'm confident of going with this now. And so when The Biggest Secret came out, I said that in it that Ted Heath, who was still an MP and didn't die until 7 years after the book came out, that he was a serial paedophile. My good, serial paedophile, are you having a laugh? Stunning. A child killer, a child torturer. Within days of the book coming out, a journalist, of what passes for one, rang Ted Heath and read the passage to him. 7 years before he died, he could have stopped me by going to court there and then. Nothing. Nothing. All he said was that David Icke must be mad. And then and nothing happened. And what's happened, of course, since the Jimmy Savile thing, which we'll get into, is that other people are now naming Ted Heath and his connections to Jimmy Savile, who is a record-breaking paedophile, yes, but as we'll get to, a record-breaking child procurer for the rich and famous as well, which is why he was so close to the royal family and so close to the Thatcher government. And another person I met in that period in North Wales while I was researching this, and I went to North Wales because there was a big scandal emerging of a massive paedophile ring involving so-called care homes and children in North Wales. And the person I met was called Andrea Davison. I met her at her home. Andrea Davison was a British intelligence operative, later became also a mental health advocate. And she, in her work, line of work, had come across all these victims of paedophilia by the elite, rich and famous. And she actually represented the victims at the so-called inquiry into these care home scandals in North Wales. She will come up as we go along more prominently. I was picking up information from her and others, and it was started. I picked up about Dolphin Square, this block of flats where so many MPs live close to the Houses of Parliament, and all the paedophile parties that were going on. That's in The Biggest Secret, and it's coming out now, of course, in the mainstream media that was going on at Dolphin Square. More and more information is coming out about that. And then I met a lady called Christine Fitzgerald, and this took it on to another level, because Christine Fitzgerald was a friend for 9 years, a close friend of Princess Diana. And what happened, again, synchronicity. There was this, I hadn't seen him for ages, but he was a guy who operated in kind of alternative circles, and his big thing was networking. We must network. We must get people together. So what he did, how he did it, I don't know. He organized this little meeting of people at the House of Lords. I've only been to the Houses of Parliament twice, and this was the other kind. Actually, the other time I went to the Houses of Parliament was to watch a debate during the Thatcher era, and I just got in at the end of it when they were voting, and I'll never forget it. The Deputy Prime Minister, Willie Whitelaw, deputy to Margaret Thatcher, came in at the top of the chamber, and he was so absolutely paralytically drunk. He staggered across to one side, hit a bench, staggered across to the other side, hit the bench, and then someone had to grab him and help him. He just voted. These are the kind of people that we have running our lives, ladies and gentlemen. It's about time they weren't. Anyway, this event at it was just a kind of an hour and a half at this in a room at the House of Lords, and it didn't really go anywhere really. But there was one person there, a lady, who said some very interesting things about Princess Diana, who had not long been killed. And afterwards, of course, being a researcher, I pulled her across. How do you know this? And she told me that her friend Christine Fitzgerald, who was an alternative healer, who operated at that time out of a clinic near Regent's Park in London, was a close friend of Princess Diana, and she thought that Christine Fitzgerald would talk to me. So I said, I want to talk to her. So a few days later, Christine Fitzgerald and this other lady, they walk off the Isle of Wight ferry, where I live, and we sat down, and I've still got the tapes to this day. I recorded it all. And she was telling me about Jimmy Savile, among other things. She's telling me about the horrific treatment of Princess Diana by the royal family, how the royal family actually weren't human, which is something I'd come across from many other sources. But here was this lady coming from that point of view as well. And that Jimmy Savile was a vile man, a paedophile, and a necrophiliac. He liked to have sex with dead bodies. This is why Jimmy Savile, for people in other parts of the world, was an, quote, entertainer and a disc jockey, worked a lot for the BBC. This is why Jimmy Savile famously used to volunteer to be a porter in hospitals, because it got him access to the mortuary. I mean, this man was so unbelievably sick. Words, you know, can't be found to describe it.
Yeah.
And
yeah, yeah.
So here is a man who, it's now become clear, was a known paedophile. And what he was doing was known by police, was known by many people. And here we have the British royal family inviting him into their inner circle, to the point where, as Christine Fitzgerald told me this, because Diana told her, but it's come out in other ways in the mainstream since, he was used as a go-between, a mediator between Princess Diana and Prince Charles when their marriage was breaking up. This man's an aging disc jockey, for goodness sake. And he was brought in to the royal family inner circle, in his own words, this is, in the 1960s, by Lord Mountbatten, a known paedophile. He was connected to the Kinkora Boys Home scandal in Belfast, though it was, of course, kept quiet. Ted Heath was connected to the Kinkora Boys Home in Belfast, and so was a guy called Sir Maurice Oldfield, head of MI6. See why it doesn't come out?
Yeah.
And Lord Mountbatten was famously a mentor to both Prince Philip and Prince Charles. And Jimmy Savile said that he was liked by the royal family and invited into their inner circle because there is, this is his quote, "I work deep cover." Now, what
could that mean, that?
What he was doing,
yeah,
as well as his record-breaking personal paedophilia, was Jimmy Savile was procuring children for the rich and famous, including former Prime Minister and Prime Minister at the time, Ted Heath. And this is why, despite everybody knowing, lots of people knowing on the inside, and the police knowing, he was never collared while he was alive, because his back was being watched by the very establishment for whom he was supplying children. Because people had to watch his back if they were going to watch their own. And so here we had a situation, again, as with Father George Bush. You cannot get anywhere near the British royal family, never mind the inner circle, without MI5 and Special Branch and all these Secret Service operations knowing every time you flipping cough. And here was a record-breaking paedophile and procurer of children for the rich and famous in the inner circle of the British royal family, taken there, invited there by a paedophile Lord Mountbatten, and MI5 and Special Branch did nothing.
They must have known.
And the royal family didn't know? Are you kidding?
They must have known. I've had this argument with people who listen to this program and who used to watch us when we were in London. And I've had this argument with them. I've said the same thing, you know, basically quoting from you. I've said, how could they not know that? How could they not know who this guy was? You know, somebody getting that deep in to the family, having that much access. How could they not know what this guy was doing and how often he was doing it? I totally agree. I can't. Look, I'm not stupid. They had to know.
Let me give...
Can we take a quick break, Cammy? Do you want to take a quick 90-second break? Let's get a break out of the way, right?
Okay.
Yeah, want to take a quick break, yeah.
We're going to go on to midnight, are we? Because there's so much to get through.
Yeah, there's so much to get into. We're with David Icke. If you're just joining the program, David is with us for the 2 hours of the show tonight. We're talking about his investigations of institutional paedophilia. We're talking about The Biggest Secret, a book where David published in 1998 and named names at that time and challenged those names, many of them alive, like George H.W. Bush and others, to prove otherwise or to take him on in court. Of course, it never happened. We'll be back in a couple of minutes after these messages. Stay here. And when we come back, just before David kicks on again, I'm going to mention a couple of comments that came into the program tonight. Back in a minute. It's at the top of the hour. This is the Richie Allen Show live on, well, on Fab Radio International, Talk Radio Europe. And of course, it's going out live on davidicke.com. David is still with us. David, I'm just going to read out two comments. There's hundreds. And then it's back over to you. Okay. This from Dawn. Now, I gleaned these comments from quite a few places. I got them from your Facebook page, our own here at the show, emails and tweets. Dawn Allen, who wrote this on your Facebook page. In 1982, I went out with a guy who told me how when he was 15 and in trouble with the police in Rotherham, him and others he knew were forcibly taken to sex parties and had to perform sex acts for judges, barristers and high-ranking cops in exchange for drugs and sentences being dropped. He wasn't gay, but he said he did what he did because he had to. He had no choice. They threatened the boys and their families, saying to them, "We can make people disappear, you know." I've never forgotten his words. They left a lasting impression on me. That was Dawn. This one coming in from Tony. Tony Cole. These animals are in charge and always will be. The British public just seem to take this shit and do nothing. It's time for change, big change. We need to destroy the whole despicable lot of them. There isn't one straight-talking person among them in the so-called parliament. They're all pedos and liars. That's not true, Tony. They're not all pedos and liars. And corrupt people who run the system, they all need to be dealt with. But the sheep will do F all, he says. The Dawn Allen comment from 1982, that's powerful, David.
That's how it works. You know, you hear these stories again and again and again, not just in this country, I stress, all over the world. And the common themes are incredible. And that's a classic of its kind. And let's just, for people that think the royal family would never do that. Well, the royal family is not what you think it is. The royal family is grotesque in every way imaginable. And one of the things that Christine Fitzgerald told me about her close relationship with Diana for 9 years and what happened was the day that she came in a terrible state into Christine Fitzgerald's healing clinic and why, which I'll get to in a second. But what Christine Fitzgerald said Diana told her in 1989 was that they, the royal family and the establishment, were going to kill her. And she, Christine told me that there were friendly people in the intelligence operation, including a former member of the elite regiment, the SAS, who used to drop things in for information in and notes in to the clinic, knowing that Diana would come along for treatment and would be able to read them. And they were warning her that her life was in danger. And so when this butler, Paul Burrell, came out years later and produced the letter that Diana had written to him saying in October 1996, which said in the letter to Burrell, "I am sitting here at my desk today in October, longing for someone to hug me and encourage me to keep strong and hold my head high. This particular phase of my life is the most dangerous. My husband is planning an accident in my car, brake failure and serious head injury in order to make the path clear for Charles to marry." Now, that was no surprise to me whatsoever. Less than a year later, she died in a car accident. Of course, it wasn't an accident. But this is what was going on in the background. So by the sort of the late 1980s, when the marriage to Charles was all breaking down, Diana started a relationship with a guy called Barry Manicky, her personal detective. But he died in a, quote, motorcycle accident in 1988. And by 1990, well known, of course, in the media, Diana was having a relationship with a guy called Captain James Hewitt. So at this time, while this relationship with Ewart's going on, and the, these years after the Barry Manicky had died in a motorcycle accident, Christine told me this. Diana came in a terrible state. And I'm going to quote Christine word for word from the tape recording. She, Diana, was crying hysterically. And I said, what's the matter? You know, it was dog died stuff, bottom lip out, full sob. She came galloping through the door. I gave her rescue remedy, clutched her, hugged her, calmed her down, and said, now tell me what's going on. I can't believe it. I can't believe it. They killed him, she sobbed. I said, who did they kill? She told me about her affair with the detective, Barry Manicky, and how he was decapitated on a motorbike and how she thought it was a terrible accident. But now she knows the royal family killed him because Prince Charles's senior detective has just told her that if she didn't call it with Ewart, the same would happen to him. He told her she shouldn't think that she was indispensable either. So Diana had been unaware at the time that the death of Barry Manicky. She didn't know. But she told Christine Fitzgerald that she found out that Manicky was dead while she was being driven with Prince Charles to the airport to fly out to the Cannes Film Festival. He waited until she was about to get out of the car in front of waiting photographers, and then he said, according to Christine Fitzgerald, Diana told her, oh, by the way, I got word from the protection unit yesterday that poor Barry Manicky was killed. Some sort of motorcycle accident. Terrible shame, isn't it? And Diana burst into tears, but Charles said, let's go, darling. Your press awaits you. And years later, in 1998, there was an independent television documentary, Diana, Secrets of the Crash. And James Ewart said that he, too, had been warned to stop seeing Diana or the consequences would not be pleasant. Here's a quote from him. The telephone calls were anonymous, but left me in no doubt that they knew what the situation was. They were threatening. They said it was not conducive to my health to continue the relationship. And he said there were warnings from Diana's personal police protection officers, from the royal household, and from a member of the royal family who he didn't name.
This is Ewart talking now.
This is Ewart talking.
Ewart, right.
The member of the royal family said, your relationship is known about. It is not supported. We cannot be responsible for your safety and security and suggest that you curtail it forthwith. And he also said, James Ewart, or quoted in the London Times, about threats and his comments supported completely the story that Diana told about Christine Fitzgerald about Barry Manicky. Ewart said that his clearest warning came when he was told that he would suffer the same fate as Barry Manicky. So any idea, Rich, that this crowd of parasites would not kill people if it suits them? Remember this. When you join the intelligence agencies, the police, the military, the clergy, all of this stuff, you do not say a oath of allegiance to the country and to the people of the country, you say it to the monarch, to the queen. And it's said that, oh, no, they're only here to bring the tourists in. Nonsense. The whole structure is structured so that the power is within the non-elected, not the elected. And so when you think that Jimmy Savile, this record-breaking paedophile, was in that inner circle, I mean, what is going on? And you see, when Savile died, he was extremely rich. He owned a £160,000 Rolls Royce. He had five other cars, a Bentley, a Mercedes. He had something like eight homes, left millions in his will on top of that. This is an aging disc jockey who has no conspicuous means of earning a living for decades and decades. But where was his money coming from? Procuring children for the rich and famous. He was given a knighthood by the royals. He was given a papal knighthood by Pope John Paul II. Of course, the Roman Catholic Church, one of the great paedophile networks on planet Earth, if not the biggest. And we will find with the passage of time that we had a pope in Benedict who resigned, the first pope to do so in 600 years, because it was connected to all this stuff. I remember someone sent me a link to a program on American television exposing the fact, I mean, researchers like me knew about it anyway, but exposing it on a public stage, that Pope Benedict was given the job by Pope John Paul II to look after all the paedophile allegations about the Roman Church, and all came out, and how it was suppressed, and how Benedict was all part of the suppression. And that was the same week that he actually resigned as Pope. So we're looking at, and I hope we'll get it for the end of the program, we're looking at a global network of paedophilia stroke Satanism, because they are, as I keep saying, connected. And there's a reason why the ratio of paedophiles among the so-called elite bloodlines and families is far greater than it is in the general population. Now, this Saville thing, of course, after he died in 2011, started to open up something else I wrote about in The Biggest Secret, which is this paedophile ring in the Thatcher government. I'll say, first of all, yes, there was a massive paedophile ring in the Thatcher government, which is now beginning to come out even through the mainstream media. But, and I'll go into it in detail, but don't let anyone get kidded that it was in the Thatcher government and the Thatcher government alone. It wasn't. It's still going on today. It's not changed. It's just changed its personnel. So Margaret Thatcher, first of all, her father, Alfred Roberts, in the corner shop in Grantham, was notorious in that town for his attraction, shall we say, to very young girls.
Now, for our listeners who maybe they're hearing this for the first time, tell us how, because I know this, of course, let them know how we know this, because it's more than anecdotal evidence about this guy.
Well, it's people in Grantham and girls who worked at the shop, and also there have been some mainstream journalists that have uncovered this. I think there was a very good series of articles in The Independent, I think, about it. But so here we have, at the same time, Jimmy Savile, curer of children for the rich and famous on a mega scale, was an inner circle member of the royal family. He was a very close friend of Margaret Thatcher through the 80s, from 79 to 1990, Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. And they spent many, many, times together. And Ted Heath was the leader of the Conservative Party, Thatcher's party, up to 1975. Very, very closely connected to Jimmy Savile, and had children on a major scale procured for him by Jimmy Savile. And then in comes Margaret Thatcher to replace Heath as leader of the Conservative Party in 1975. And she strikes up this close relationship with Jimmy Savile. He's an aging disc jockey. I mean, hello?
Yeah, he wasn't Mr. Personality, was he? I mean, he wasn't in real life. However, I don't care what people think of him on television. This was not a nice guy. So why this guy would, you know, why you'd be rushing to befriend this guy is, like you said, it's staggering, the access this guy had.
And when you then look at the Thatcher administration, you can start to see why there is this massive panic on to keep the lid on this. First of all, from 1975, when she became leader of the Conservative Party, to the time she left as Prime Minister in 1990, one of her closest, closest inner circle aides was a man called Peter Morrison, MP for Chester, which is just a tiny few miles from North Wales, where that big scandal went on, and he was part of it. He was one of the people that was abusing children in the North Wales children's homes. Peter Morrison was a well-known paedophile by those people around him. That cabinet would have known Peter Morrison was a paedophile. The other Svengali figure, fixer, spinner, and Conservative Party treasurer, getting all the money for the elections, again, the entire Thatcher years from 75 to 1990 was Lord Alistair McAlpine, who, of course, was the center of a paedophile allegation scandal in, was it 2012? Well, I name Lord Alistair McAlpine for paedophilia in The Biggest Secret. And that came out in 1998. And he did nothing. He was exposed by Scallywag magazine on a major scale. I mean, the headline was Lord McAlpine and the paedophile ring. I mean,
that's right, that's
pulling
right
punches. And if people go to my website, they go to my headlines page and go down the right-hand column, you'll find a link to that Scallywag, those Scallywag magazine articles, where you'll see what they said. McAlpine did not sue. And so he is at the side of Margaret Thatcher, and on the other, throughout the Thatcher years, and on the other side of Thatcher is Peter Morrison, who is a well-known paedophile. One of the things that came out about Alistair McAlpine is he also had a collection of photographs or paintings, rather, by a guy called Graham Ovenden. And these were photographs of prepubescent girls in naked and erotic poses. And Ovenden was actually jailed for paedophilia in 2013. Also in the cabinet of or in the government of Margaret Thatcher was Keith Joseph. He's been named by victims as a person who abused them at paedophile parties, and a guy called Rhodes Boyson, a minister, the same thing. Now, who else, Rich, was in that Thatcher government at the center of it in many ways, certainly in a major position as Home Secretary? Leon Britton. Now, Leon Britton is now at the center of allegations of a cover-up of a dossier of political and VIP paedophiles given to him when he was Home Secretary in the 1980s by Jeffrey Dickens MP, who was a big campaigner against paedophiles. And Leon Britton must have known that Peter Morrison was a paedophile, because where was he if they didn't? Why didn't he make that public? Why didn't he have Peter Morrison prosecuted? Here you have Peter Morrison. He was known about by the newspapers. Newspapers were trying to name him, but they pulled back because he threatened to sue them.
Yeah.
And then you have Rod Richards, the former Conservative MP and the former leader of the Conservative Party in Wales, who said this: "What I know is that Morrison was a paedophile. And the reason I know is that because of the North Wales child abuse scandal." And he said that William Hague, who has been Foreign Secretary until very recently in the Cameron government, he was Welsh Secretary at the time of the inquiry into the North Wales abuse. And here's Rod Richards, a member of Hague's party, saying that Hague should have seen the evidence about Morrison. Why didn't William Hague have Morrison prosecuted?
Why didn't he act on it?
The people are in that government have been prosecuted.
David, can you just stop there, because we're getting out for news now. So okay,
I've got to just get this in. William Hague was a close friend of Leon Britton and replaced him as MP for Richmond in Yorkshire. So all these things connect all the time. And I want to get into Edwina Curry's diaries next.
Brilliant stuff. David Icke is staying with us for the full show. We'll be back just after the news with more explosive stuff. I'm going to disconnect from you, David. Don't worry about it. We'll reconnect just at the end of the news there. David will be back with us for the second hour. Explosive stuff. All of this documented, by the way. I want to say a very quick special thank you to the company who streams us here, Amicus in Manchester, because they've facilitated more listeners coming online to listen to this tonight. We normally get between 20 and 30,000 listeners live a night on a certain amount of streams that we can pay for. To their eternal credit, this company, they've given us some more space, because the interest in this is absolutely phenomenal. We've been talking with David Icke. We're going to do so again for the next hour, talking about his book, The Biggest Secret, 25 years of talking about things that he was initially laughed at for, then he was ridiculed, then he was ignored as he was saying these things, which are now unfolding in the national press in this country. And I said on Friday night, and I meant it, the BBC don't get any credit for bringing on these victims of these horrible crimes now. They're only doing it because they know they can't keep the lid on it any longer, and they want to look like they're at the forefront of the revelations. But of course they've not, because they're only saying now what David was saying for the best part of a quarter of a century. Welcome back, mate. Sorry to disconnect from you there. I did a stupid thing. I had you on the same channel as the news, like the idiot that I am. That's why I kind of dumped you out there. My apologies.
No problem, mate. We're talking just now about McAlpine and the way that he was in the middle of that scandal in 2012. Well, I sat in this very chair shaking my head in that period, because Just for people around the world who maybe don't know about it, he was named as a paedophile, but he wasn't. There was an interview on the BBC which didn't name him, and then there was an interview on independent television which didn't name him, and somehow McAlpine got paid out hundreds of thousands of pounds from both parties in a libel settlement. He also threatening to sue people on Twitter who hadn't named him. He sued the wife of the Speaker of the House of Commons, who hadn't actually said he was a paedophile. And when it all came out in 2012, given what I'd written in The Biggest Secret back in the late 90s, I put on my website, he's a paedophile. This is what's in The Biggest Secret. I'm naming him amid all this stuff. What did I get? Nothing. And I said before the news about Edwina Curry's diaries. Edwina Curry was a minister in the Thatcher government, and she wrote diaries about her various experiences. And one of them involved, or one comment involved, Peter Morrison, this notorious paedophile at the right hand of Margaret Thatcher throughout her period in office. And I've got the diaries in front of me, and this one's from 1990. House of Commons, Tuesday, 24th of July, 11:15 p.m. And she says here about a government reshuffle, a Thatcher government reshuffle. And she says, one appointment in the recent reshuffle has attracted a lot of gossip and could be very dangerous. Peter Morrison has become the PM's PPS, Parliamentary Private Secretary of Margaret Thatcher, PM, Prime Minister, for those around the world. Now, he, Morrison, is what they call a noted paedocast, she says, with a liking for young boys. He admitted as much to Norman Tebbit, who was chairman of the Conservative Party, very close associate of Margaret Thatcher. Morrison admitted as much to Norman Tebbit when he became deputy chairman of the party. But Morrison added, however, I'm very discreet. And Curry says, and he must be. She says, she, Margaret Thatcher, either knows and is taking a chance or doesn't. Either way, it's a really dumb move. And she says, Theresa Gorman, another MP, told me this evening in a taxi coming back from a drinks party at the BBC that she inherited Morrison's agent, who claimed to have been offered money to keep quiet about his activities. Curry says, it scares me, as all the press know, and as we get closer to the election, someone is going to make trouble very close to her indeed. So a couple of things there. First of all, Edwina Curry, why are they in your diaries? Why aren't you telling the police? Why aren't you making it public? And here is the chairman of Mr. Moral Fiber, Mr. Morality, Norman Tebbit, who she's saying knew that Morrison was a paedophile, still made him a deputy chairman of the Conservative Party because he said he'd be discreet. This is what was going on, and it's still going on in government and politics, Westminster and Washington in general.
And I just say very quickly, to Edwina's credit, she came on our TV show, didn't she, in London, and we asked her about that. And, she said that suspicions were really suspicions. And
they weren't.
That's what she said. Yeah, that's what she said to me on the air.
Suspicions. They're not saying we think he might be.
Yeah, they're saying
he absolutely was. And it's clear from the evidence that people knew that he was. Now, this next thing brings Andrea Davison back, the British intelligence operative at one time, who was someone who compiled an enormous amount of evidence and documentation to do with the exposing of political and rich and famous paedophiles. But her documentation, which included information given to her by the MP Geoffrey Dickens of political paedophile dossier fame, was taken in a raid at her home in North Wales by North Wales and Derby police. So when we are supposed to be having this debate, oh, was the Jeffrey Dickens dossier given to Leon Britton with all the names of the VIP paedophiles, was it lost by accident or what? Oh, it's a mystery. It's not a mystery. They wanted to clean out all copies and all confirmations of what was in the Dickens dossier, and Andrea Davison had some of that, and thus the raid by the police. And I want to quote her here because this is so enlightening. There's a review was started called the Macquer Review into the inquiry into the North Wales paedophile scandal. So we're having a review, an inquiry into the inquiry. And what they're doing, and they're doing this with the police investigations as well, they're having so many inquiries and inquiries into inquiries and so many police investigations under different names, Operation Cover-Up and all that, that people are getting lost in the complexity of it all. But what Andrea Davison did was give a long statement to this Macquer Review talking about what happened in North Wales and how this cover-up goes on. And she sent me a copy, and you can now get it on the internet. If you put Andrea Davison Macquer Review statement, Macquer, M-A-C-U-R, you'll see it in full. But I just want to pick these bits out of it. This is from her statement to this review. And this is someone who's investigated political and VIP paedophilia for a long time. Photographic evidence of child abuse is destroyed by order of the court. Provable fact. The Gillings report, that was yet another report into the North Wales scandal, into child abuse in North Wales, was also ordered to be pulped by order of the county council. Investigators and whistleblowers, evidence of child abuse is seized. Evidence of child brothels, transportation routes, hotels and bars, fixers, providers of false documents and outlets for the trade in images of child abuse and snuff videos that have been identified is also ignored. And tragically, all the evidence either disappears or is ignored. And very quickly before I go on, there is a structure. And it's like a transnational corporation. If you look at a transnational corporation, it has a headquarters, it's at a central point. And then all the subsidiaries of that central point operate according to the diktats of the central point. So if you go into a McDonald's in any country, you're basically going to the same McDonald's. This is the structure. Well, the structure of paedophilia and Satanism and secret societies, come to that, is just the same. And so if you think of a pyramid, at the top of the pyramid, you've got a tiny few people. The further you come down the pyramid, you're meeting more and more people. Now, in these paedophile satanic rings, the few people at the top are the only ones that know how the whole thing fits together and what's really going on. And the further you come down that pyramid, people know less and less and less. And of course, if you look at any organization, including, for instance, the police, they're all structured in this hierarchical pyramid structure. And this means that you do not have to control every policeman or even close to every policeman. There's a lot of good policemen out there, police officers out there, who are stymied and suppressed and oppressed by the system. But you only have to control those positions within the police that dictate what's going to be prosecuted and what's not going to be prosecuted. And if you can also control the hire and fire positions, then you can make in the upper echelon, then you can make sure that the key positions are peopled by your people within your network. And this is how it works. And so through this pyramidal system, these paedophile rings infiltrate politics. They infiltrate, as I've said, the police, the judiciary, the media, and so on. And so through this structure, this is how it's done, which will become relevant as I continue with Andrea Davison's statement here to the Macquer Review. She said, "The majority of my documentary evidence was taken by 19 North Wales and Derby police officers, headed by DC Winard and DS Hunt on January 13th, 2010, who emptied my three flats of documents and valuables. The warrant was signed by Derby Judge Burgess. A full list of the thousands of documents taken has never been provided, neither has a list been provided of the thousands of pounds worth of gold jewellery and heirlooms seized at the same time. Over 3 years later, nothing seized has been returned. It's now four. I made a concerted effort, she said, to get my documents about illegal arms sales and child abuse and journalistic material back from the Derby and North Wales police. But whoever was behind the raid on my property had enough power to ignore legitimate requests for the documents' return. Clearly, DC Winard and DS Hunt were not acting on their own, as sanction would be required to look at, let alone seize, steal, and keep documents and computers from a prominent intelligence agent and her tenant, who also had top clearance, secret clearance. On the 17th of March and April 2010, Lord Hoyle of Warrington wrote to the Chief Constable of Derby, Mike Creedon, later to be Chief Constable of North and later the Chief Constable of North Wales, Mark Poland, asking them to return the seized documents taken in those raids on Andrea Davison and the property taken from her and her tenant. And he asked them to return all the documents. Now, wait for this. This is how desperate they are to keep this quiet, and this is how they operate to make sure it does stay quiet. This is what Andrea says that happened after this Lord Hoyle said, give her her documents back. The result was that the Derby police obtained a restraint order on her from Judge Burgess, the guy who gave the warrant to take the documents, on April the 7th, 2010, which put a veneer, she says, of legitimacy over the police holding all my property and all my documents, including excluded documents, and prevented anyone asking for their return. Now, it gets worse. To prevent me challenging the restraint order of the court, the court made it a contempt of court for me to pay for legal advice or assistance.
That's incredible.
I applied for legal aid, but this was refused. This tactic has resulted in not one document or item of property being returned over 3 years. Now, of course, we know, because it's now documented, how the intelligence agencies and the police stopped the truth about the paedophile MP Cyril Smith coming out, which it is now come out. But this is what is going on. And there was another aide to Margaret Thatcher, who was named by Scallywag magazine, and his name was Derek Lord, and he's still around. And interestingly, at the time that the McAlpine scandal broke in 2012, two paragraphs were removed from Derek Lord's Wikipedia entry. One of them that was removed and has not been put back, I looked today, said this: Lord is a long-standing family friend of Samantha Cameron's family, that's the wife of the current Prime Minister, and a personal friend of David Cameron, and attended their wedding at Ginge in Oxfordshire. He has a wide circle of friends in the celebrity, political, and business communities. The other thing that was removed from that Wikipedia page at the time said this: Lord has a wide circle of friends in the Conservative Party. The list of Tory friends with whom he is known to go on holiday and socialise with is illustrious and includes Lord McAlpine, Peter Lilly and Michael Portillo. Now, why would you want to remove something like that from a Wikipedia entry? Doesn't follow. And you see there what Andrea Davison was saying about the way that it's covered up. And you mentioned earlier this MP that's come out now today,
John Mann, yeah,
the Labour MP, who said that he reported these paedophile parties at Dolphin Square near Houses of Parliament and other London locations, and how the police basically put the lid on it and did not investigate. And he said that The inquiry, the case was closed within 3 months on orders of those at the top. Now we're back to this pyramid structure, Rich. The police officers lower down may want to investigate this. They may be outraged by it. I'm sure many are. But this structure of control the positions that decide if a prosecution is going to happen or not happen, and you control the game. And that is how it is done. And this brings us, after all this evidence, so this is a fraction of what you could give, but it's enough to make the picture. We come to the blatant attempt to put safe people in charge of this new inquiry now into what happened to the Jeffrey Dickens dossier that was given to Leon Britton as Home Secretary with these paedophile names in it, which disappeared. The first person, and we've got to look at this Home Secretary, Theresa May, who's appointed the two heads so far, both of which through public pressure and exposure have had to step down. We have to look at Theresa May and ask this: why are you putting people in charge of an inquiry that so blatantly and so obviously, as we've seen, will have no confidence from the victims that are supposed to be helped here by this inquiry? They would have no confidence in the two people she's put forward. The first one she put forward, Baroness Butler Sloss. Now, you know, if you're around the world and you've not come across this story, I am not making this up. I have to make that point because most people would think I would. It's so ludicrous. The Attorney General, Sir Michael Havers, this major, major law officer in the Thatcher administration, at the time that Leon Britton was Home Secretary, at the time this Dickens dossier was handed over and went missing, Sir Michael Havers is someone who has quite blatantly suppressed the prosecution of known paedophiles, including a diplomat called Sir Peter Hayman. And in recent times, Sir Michael Havers has been named as one of these people at these paedophile parties. Now, Baroness Butler Sloss, who was appointed by the Home Secretary Theresa May to oversee the investigation into what happened in that period that Sir Michael Havers was Attorney General and Leon Britton, Butler Sloss is Michael Havers' sister.
Yeah, this is it, yeah.
You could not make that up. And this is another thing about Butler Sloss. She was appointed, again during the Thatcher period, to lead an inquiry into child abuse in Cleveland, in the north of England. It was reported in 1988. Now, this is what the Guardian newspaper said about the way Butler Sloss handled that investigation into child abuse in the 1980s. For all the blather about the dynastic pedigree and noble vocation of Elizabeth Butler Sloss, her 1988 report into the child abuse crisis in Cleveland in the Northeast was a model of establishment guile and bad faith. It contributed to the myth that this crisis was not about abuse at all, but mad or bad professionals, zealots who saw abuse everywhere. Her report did not ask or answer the question, were the children abused? Her focus were arrangements, not abuse. Though her report did not ultimately the diagnosis, it encouraged the myth that it was all wrong. After a trail of avoidable child deaths at the hands of cruel carers, pediatricians and child welfare professionals in Britain, child welfare professionals in Britain were under orders, thou shalt intervene. But Butler Sloss criticized them for doing that, for failing to suspend belief. That guideline to suspend belief has haunted child protection professionals ever since. Another thing about Baroness Butler Sloss: she was responsible for a controversial ruling which prevented warnings being issued about dangerous paedophiles. This is another newspaper article. Senior social workers attacked her decision, made when she was an appeal court judge, and warned that it would have major ramifications. As the government faced growing pressure to review its decision to appoint Lady Butler Sloss to the major new inquiry, one proud child protection expert said the peers' involvement in the ruling had the unintended consequence, they say, of allowing paedophiles to get away with their crimes. Of course, Butler Sloss was led the inquest into the death of Diana before she stepped down. So if you are looking at someone for whom victims will have no confidence in, given the background, not least being the sister of this Michael Havers bloke who was right at the centre of it, which she was supposed to be investigating, you would appoint Baroness Butler Sloss.
Yeah, that's right, John.
But we are entering different times, Rich, because this is now starting to get out. Victims are getting more confident. And I'll tell you why, because people are starting to listen. The frustration that they must feel when all these years, fantastic frustration seeing it, and I wasn't abused. What do they feel like? So after Baroness Butler Sloss is forced to step down, after all this comes out, Theresa May appoints Fiona Wolfe, Lord Mayor of the City of London Financial District. Now, last time I looked, there are 60-odd million people in Britain, and 60-odd million people from which you can put people in positions. And Fiona Wolfe was chosen to replace Butler Sloss to oversee a inquiry involving Leon Britton, the Home Secretary, and what happened to the dossier of paedophilia he was given. And Fiona Wolfe not only is a friend of Leon Britton and his wife, but lives in the same street. It's extraordinary. Cozy dinner parties together. Now, again, think of the last person that you would have confidence in if you were a victim wanting the truth to come out about whatever happened involving Leon Britton and this dossier. You would appoint Fiona Wolfe. So what is happening here is Theresa May came out after Fiona Wolfe had to step down when all this stuff came out, and the victim said, we're not have any confidence. Well, of course they're not. Theresa May came out, the Home Secretary, and said, it's proving very difficult to find someone who is acceptable. No, there are 60 million plus people in this country, and there are people out there that the victims would have lots of confidence in. Why it's proving difficult to find someone to run this inquiry, it's proving difficult to find someone who will keep the lid on it while having the public confidence that they're not keeping the lid on it. That's the bloody person they're looking for. And we've got to watch this like a hawk again and make sure someone else is not put on us.
They even had the cheek, David, to say we might have to go outside the country. Can I just then, because I'm going to get murdered now. I've been in commercial radio for the best part of 16 years off and on. I have never seen the overwhelming amount of correspondence come into a live show as I have here. Verifiably, Twitter, email and Facebook, we're talking hundreds and hundreds of mail. I was going to read out a quick few and then I'll shut up and let you back in then again. But I've got to read out some of these. Maureen, I don't know if anyone remembers, but around the time of the Iraq war, a lot of info came out from America on this type of stuff and then it went awfully quiet. I wonder why.
Absolutely, Andy, right.
Yeah, Andy, when it comes to VIPs doing this, the public just can't handle that this goes on amongst VIPs. Oh no, they wouldn't or couldn't do that. And there's their cover right there. What a powerful one it is. Claire, I'm furious about this. Lies, lies, lies. And now all this going on for years. These bastards must be brought to justice. Karen, this is depravity at its worst. The trouble is Westminster rely on the good old British public not to do anything. Apathy being the operative word. Steve, I remember you, David, writing about this 20-odd years ago. I was fascinated about what you was revealing about the world on its lies. Funny how those who might have laughed on the Wogan show, how they must feel right now. Tommy Wilson, there is a paedophile politician in, I'm not going to say where because he might be identified, in Australia. He was charged 3 years ago with possession of child porn, still holds his seat in Parliament, has collected over $1 million of taxpayer money since being charged, and has delivered 3 speeches to Parliament in as many years. How the F has this been allowed to happen? True story, look it up, he says. And finally, for the moment, Daniel on Twitter says, is so much of this, so not so much, it happened that long ago, but 20, 30 years, even with good police people trying to do their job, is it difficult to investigate stuff that happened so long ago? All those comments, and there's hundreds more, David. Hundreds more.
Well, I just say at this point, Australia is a massive centre for paedophilia and Satanism. And Lord McAlpine had major connections to Australia, not least a place called Broome in Western Australia. And Australia's massive, but it's everywhere. That's the point. And you know, this paedophilia is so infested in the system that it does come up everywhere. I mean, the Dunblane massacre of children in 1996 at the Dunblane Primary School in Scotland, when a guy called Thomas Hamilton shot dead 16 children and a teacher before killing himself. Thomas Hamilton was a procurer of children for the rich and famous. He was a smaller version of Jimmy Savile in Scotland. And, you know, the head or former Grand Master of Scottish Freemasonry, a guy called Lord Burton, he actually came out and said in a major national newspaper that the inquiry into Dunblane, which was headed by a Scottish judge called Lord Cullen, who also led a five-judge tribunal which heard an appeal in the conviction of the Lockerbie bomber, alleged Lockerbie bomber, and decided that he was guilty. He never was. Lord Cullen headed this inquiry, and Lord Burton, this Grand Master of Scottish Freemasonry, said in this article in this national newspaper that the inquiry, the Cullen inquiry, was a cover-up that suppressed crucial information. And he linked Cullen to what he called a super Mason group based at Edinburgh University called the Speculative Society. And Burton said that he had been bullied and threatened by other members of the House of Lords when he tried to raise concerns about the Dunblane cover-up. There's no escaping the fact, he said, there's something sinister about the whole affair. And what one of the things that Cullen did is that he ordered that significant documents relating to the case should be locked away from public view for 100 years.
100 years, yeah.
He said this was to protect the victims and the families. It wasn't. It was actually to protect the establishment. And this is what you find all the time. And so we mustn't let this momentum go. We really mustn't let this momentum go, because you know, the victims of this over the years must have just got to the point where it's lost. Nothing's ever going to happen. The establishment always going to protect itself. But that's why we need not to let them down by letting this drop and let it go away. Another guy, by the way, that I've written about involving paedophilia is Anthony Blunt. He was, a lot of people won't know this, he was the third cousin of Elizabeth Bowes Lyon, the famous Queen Mother, who was seriously into some very dark stuff. The Queen Mother died at, she's 102. And Blunt was a paedophile, and he was also part of the Russian spy ring with people like Donald McLean, Guy Burgess, and Kim Philby. And there was another person in that ring who's never been named, and his name was Lord Victor Rothschild, very close friend of Anthony Blunt. And Blunt was sent to Germany at the end of the Second World War to retrieve documents, sent by the royal family to retrieve documents that showed their collusion between the Windsors and their Nazi family in Germany during the war. And he was made surveyor of the Queen's pictures, the royal pictures, as a result, before he eventually was outed at last as a Russian spy, part of that ring at Cambridge University, or Cambridge graduates, etc., and had to step down. But wherever you look, paedophilia comes up. If we go back to what I was saying about when this started for me, and I in the 1990s, and you're going from synchronistic information to synchronistic information, and whichever major political figure that was pushing the world in the direction of this global agenda, this Orwellian agenda, the major figures invariably turned out to be members of secret societies, not surprising, paedophiles, or Satanists, and sometimes, in fact, more than sometimes, all three. And so what we're looking at is a network within the establishment that has its tentacles into all these different areas of society, into the media, corporations, banks, politics, royalty, And while on the surface, we see things that are apparently opposing each other or different, like we see a Labour Party and a Conservative Party, a Republican Party and a Democrat Party. We see this and that and all apparently apart. They're actually all brought together by this hidden hand, this hidden structure of manipulation and power in which paedophilia and Satanism are absolutely at its heart. And, you know, it's, we go deeper in the rabbit hole here. And if people think, you know, it's been challenging so far, hold on. I mentioned earlier Christine Fitzgerald. In this same period that I was traveling America and the world in general and picking up all this information that was cross-referencing and cross-checking itself about paedophilia and Satanism, I also came infamously to the information about the fact that there are hybrid bloodlines that are actually driving this structure I'm talking about, that are part human and part non-human, part human, part reptilian, although reptilian's only part of it, as I explained at length in the last book and at Wembley. And Christine Fitzgerald not only told me all about the royal family, the way they treated Diana, the way the influence and the behavior of Jimmy Savile, etc. She also confirmed to me, and just some background, I had not spoken to anybody about, the biggest secret hadn't come out. I hadn't spoken to anybody about this information about these reptilian human hybrid bloodlines. And so she had not a clue. And we're talking, me and Christine Fitzgerald, about, you know, all that's going on. And then she said something like, do you know what Diana used to call the Windsors? I said, no. She used to call them the lizards or the reptiles. And so I played the you know, the ignorant fool, because what I don't do is tell people too much if it's not in the public arena, because I don't want to, you know, influence what they're saying. So I said, what do you mean? And then she started telling me about the fact that the Windsors are actually a hybrid bloodline, part human, part reptilian. And this is exactly what I've been told by many, many other sources up to that point. And so when you think how accurate Christine Fitzgerald has been in terms of what she told me in the late 90s and what has come out. And she also told me this stuff about the fact that there are hybrid bloodlines. And it's important just to talk about this, because we're getting closer to the point of why there are so many paedophiles in the upper echelons of society. This is a direct quote from Christine Fitzgerald in actually what we're dealing with. The Queen Mother, now there's a serious piece of wizardry. The Queen Mother is a lot older than people think. To be honest, the royal family hasn't died for a long time. They've just metamorphosed. It's a sort of cloning, but in a different way. They take pieces of flesh and rebuild the body from one little bit. Because it's lizard, because it's cold-blooded, it's much easier for them to do Frankenstein shit than it is for us. The different bodies are just different electrical vibrations, and they've got that secret. They've got the secret of the microcurrents. It's so micro, so specific, these radio waves that actually create the bodies. As I've been, you know, writing and about at length, you know, the body is a hologram. It's an energetic holographic field, which fits exactly with what she's saying. They know the vibration of life, and because they're cold-blooded, they're reptiles, they have no wish to make the earth the perfect harmony it could be or heal the earth from the damage that's been done. The earth's been attacked for zeons by different extraterrestrials. It's like a bit of football for so long. This place was a bus stop for so many different aliens. All these aliens, they could cope with everything, including the noxious gases. They're landing all the time and coming up from the bowels of the earth. They looked like reptiles originally. This is why they're described as such by ancient accounts. But they look like us when they get out now through the electrical vibration, that life key I talked about. They can manifest how they want to. All the real knowledge has been taken out and shredded and put back in another way. The Queen Mother is chief toad of this part of Europe, and they have people like her in every in each continent. She was a massively high satanic witch, the Queen Mother. Most people, the hangers-on, you know, they don't know about the reptiles. They're just in awe of these people because they're so powerful. Don't think of people like the Queen Mother and Queen Victoria as different people. Think of them as the same person, which after a while has to have to replace their coat. When the flesh dies, that energy, while it's dying, will be, in her colourful language, will be immediately up someone else's jacksie, backside, for anyone not in Britain. It's very vampire, worse than vampire. They're not going to come to you with hooked teeth and suck your blood. Fear is their food. I've been saying this for all these years. They can actually take fear and manifest it into a tangible thing. That's why society is structured globally to create maximum fear. The key is the vibrational current. At that vibrational current, they can manifest anything from anything. It's like a holographic image. Here you go. We are all minerals and water vibrating. This is all an illusion we are living in. That's the secret. And she goes on. Now, how does this fit in with why these bloodlines are absolutely obsessed with paedophilia? Because these entities that go under the name of archons and jinn in the Islamic belief system and demons in the Christian belief system, all over the world they have different names, same force, same entities we're talking about. They feed off human fear, yes. They feed off human low vibrational emotional energy, fear, anxiety, all these things, depression. It's why they want a society that manifests those things. War. I mean, think of the energy that is created. Because they are operating on a very low vibrational frequency, they can only absorb energy on a very low vibrational frequency. Hence, fear is a low vibrational frequency. It's a low wavelength. And the energy they want to absorb more than anything else, it's a nectar to them, is the energy of children before puberty. We see puberty as a hormonal change. That's only happening in the holographic level, what we call the physical level. That hormonal change is actually a manifestation triggered by an energetic change at the deeper energetic levels. They want that energy before that energetic change takes place. And this has been talked about by people like shaman around the world through vast amounts of time. Here's a quote from a Central American shaman quoted in the Carlos Castaneda books. Sorcerers, in this context, people that can see energy beyond what normally people can see with their eyes. Sorcerers see infant human beings as strange luminous balls of energy, covered from the top to the bottom with a glowing coat, something like a coat of plastic adjusted tightly around the cocoon of energy. This glowing coat of awareness is what the predators, these entities I'm talking about, consume. And when a human reached adulthood, all that is left of that fringe awareness is a narrow fringe that goes from the ground to the top of the toes. That fringe permits mankind to keep on living, but only barely. And so what is happening is that while the paedophile, and these are possessed people, these are either entities of the hybrid bloodline, or they are possessed by these entities. And they have this urge for sexual abuse of children. While the sexual abuse is going on, they are used as a conduit for the entity beyond human sight to draw off the child's energy through the paedophile and steal and absorb the child's energy. Now, if you can do that while the child is deeply distressed and deeply traumatized, which is what is happening, then you absorb the child's energy on the low vibrational frequency that you need it to be for you to have the capacity to absorb it, because radio one can't absorb radio two. They're on different frequencies. So this is what is happening. They traumatize the children purposely. They torture the children purposely. And so many of them, once the energy has been taken, are then killed so that they can't tell the story of the people they recognize, famous people in society who've done it to them. So what is happening is that the energy of children is being stolen in this way, and this is why these hybrid bloodlines are so awash with pedophiles and pedophilia, why so many children are abused worldwide. It's staggering. You know, I was telling you earlier in the day, Richie, there was a lady I met in America whose husband had just been murdered, and they'd taken her children away. They were foster children, but they were in the process of adopting them. It's very clear from the story, because I spent a long time helping this lady and working on this, that they wanted the children for some reason, and they were taken away and given to someone else. Very strange people, actually, a strange person. They said that now the husband was dead, this lady couldn't bring them up alone, and then they gave the children to a woman living on her own. Anyway, where I'm going with this is that as part of this investigation, I rang the federal government agency in Washington to ask how many children went missing every year in America.
Great question, yeah.
They told me they didn't keep the figures. They could tell me how many cars went missing, apparently, but they couldn't tell me how many children went missing. They said I would have to ring every state because they only kept the records at a state level. But certainly then, that's what they told me. I must have got to 9 or 10 states, Rich, including California, before I stopped, because the figure was absolutely friggin' fantastic by then.
Tens of thousands. Hundreds of thousands. I remember you telling
me. And it's like, what? That doesn't mean they all go missing, never to be found. Some of them are found. They're here, there, or wherever. Vast numbers of them are not found. And this is the public perception, which needs to change. And I completely understand why this this perception is held by people. They judge the number of children that go missing by the number of missing children stories on the mainstream news, in the mainstream media. So Madeleine McCann, a big story, yeah. But Madeleine McCann is the tip of the tip of the tip of the tip of the tip, and I could go on for hours, of the iceberg. But the vast majority of these kids that go missing are never appearing in the mainstream media. Overwhelming, only a few ever do, the high-profile cases. They go missing and they're never seen again. Vast numbers. And I talked to Credo Mutwa, the shaman, the Zulu shaman in South Africa. Same happening there. Children just disappear. It's unbelievable the number of children that go missing every year in this world. And it's all connected to what I've just described. And when you look, because everything connects to everything else, when you look at the way the laws are changing, the way the behavior of social services, not just in this country, but in America, elsewhere, is changing, so that they're now taking more and more and more children from loving parents, and the state is taking control of them. When they're now introducing laws in Britain about emotional abuse, which is not defined. So actually, you know, grounding someone, a kid, for doing something that's not acceptable can easily be called emotional abuse in this context.
Yeah.
These laws are all being brought in for one simple reason alone, to give more and more reasons for the state to take away children from loving parents. And I tell you this, people, if you don't think this is your problem and you've got kids, well, I should have another think, because I would hate the knock to come on your door when it's too late.
10,000 a year.
We've got to stand together here and stand up for these families that are having their children taken away from loving parents. And the reason we have secret courts where the media is not allowed to report these cases is not to protect the child. It's to protect the system from stealing children. And there are some journalists, like Christopher Booker in the Telegraph in this country, who've done some fantastic work exposing this against tremendous pressure of the courts dictating what he can and cannot say, or they'll prosecute him. This is what's going on in the world while we're watching freaking X Factor. This is what's going on in the world while we're watching all these diversions and celebrities and all these bloody reality shows. This is what is going on. This is what is happening to our children. And anyone's got respect for children, including their own children, off the arse, let's get started. And let's get this information circulating big time. Take this interview, for instance. Send it everywhere. Let's get people aware that the world is not like they thought it was. Because I would rather they found out while we still have time to change it, and don't find out when the knock comes on their door and it's too late.
I just want to say a couple of things. There's been a number of people who have emailed and said that they used to think the dark energies and the archons, they used to think that was very fantastic. But they've come to believe that you're definitely more than onto something when you talk about that. A lot of people have said that. In the interest of balance, William in Spain said that he thinks that at this point, this is where it loses a bit of credibility. That's William in Spain. But a lot of people, I mean, I used to think...
Can I just say something, Richard?
You can. Go ahead.
Right. One of the greatest forms of suppression is the suppression of people's perception of the possible. If you can squeeze their perception of the possible, then you can operate outside that perception of the possible, and you can do all the things that I'm saying, all the things happening that I'm saying, but people will dismiss it because it's outside the bounds of their programmed sense of the possible. Oh, yeah. When I first came out and said all this paedophilia was going on and involved the Thatcher government, it involved all these people, all those years ago, people laughed and said, that's ridiculous. This is where, mate, you lose your credibility. Now it's coming out. And it's not the fact that this stuff with the archons and what have you and all this stuff I'm talking about is not happening. It's the fact that so many people are so programmed from cradle to grave with a minute sense of the possible that they cannot perceive it's possible. There's a big lesson here. Just because you can't perceive it does not mean it's not happening.
You're living proof.
We are learning that lesson so big time now as this lid comes off.
You're living proof of it. I mean, I talk to people all the time who, I mean, we met so many youngsters in London. When I say youngsters, 20-somethings, late teenagers, who said, you know, I'm really into what's happening. I've read some of your books. I've looked at the films. It's making sense to me. I've done my own research. I would have said it. I think the first time we ever spoke on the radio, I think I kind of semi-rudely said, look, I don't want to get into all that other stuff. Let's talk about the money and the bank and all that sort of thing. And you, being you, you know, politely said, yeah, okay, let's get into all of that. Of course, I'm in a very different place now, and I'm happy to be there in terms of I totally and utterly understand it and believe that that's exactly what's happening. It's staggering to me that people can't see it now. You know, and I love one of the emails that just came in. I've just lost it off my screen now. And again, it was somebody saying, I believe what David is saying because of the scale of it. You can't just get that many people around the world who are just into interfering with kids just because they're getting off on sexual kicks.
Exactly.
It just can't be. And that person is right. Yeah.
And see, when you read like this MP man today and others, and you read victims and what they say, they're saying like these paedophile parties at Dolphin Square next to Parliament, they're saying they didn't even try to hide it. They didn't even try to hide themselves, and they just were kind of open about it, you know, in these parties. And the reason they were so open about it in the way that these victims describe is because they know that the system is so stitched up in terms of their kind, their network being in control of law enforcement and government and media and all of this, that they can almost flaunt it in a way. But what they didn't bargain for was people outside of the mainstream system who were going to grab them by the tail and refuse to let go. That's what they didn't bargain for. And now it's starting to come out and they're running for cover. Well, there ain't a cover big enough, ladies and gentlemen. It's coming out and the game's going to be up. And we must not let this go away. You know, what was that quote I used at Wembley, something like when we've exhausted every possibility, let's get started.
Yeah, that's right.
Right. Let's come together here and put down our differences, whether we believe this or believe that, whether you see it like that, put it down. There are vast numbers of children being abused, tortured, and murdered. I love it. You know, this week the police are investigating a possible murder involving this political paedophile ring. A murder. My goodness me, the scale is fantastic, and they can cover it up because of all these things. In fact, there was a paedophile in Australia. Not a paedophile, well, he might have been, but he was a Satanist in Australia. And before he died, he produced a document not apologizing for Satanism, but actually flaunting it. And this is what he said. I've got a quote here about the abuse of children. He said, "Politicians are introduced by a carefully graded set of criteria and situations that enable them to accept that their victims will be, quote, our little secret. Young children sexually molested and physically abused by politicians worldwide are quickly used in sacrifices. In Australia, the bodies are hardly ever discovered, for Australia is still a wilderness." Now, our little secret. This is one of the things they do, and this is what intelligence people were doing in North Wales as well. You get these politicians involved in sex with children, you film it secretly, and that politician will then pass any law you want for the rest of his political career.
Bought and paid for. Do you know what?
And paid for. Ted Heath was one of those. And this is why you get politicians doing things that appear to be against everything they've ever stood for. It's because if they don't, it comes out. So they do it. And this paedophilia is another aspect, a very important aspect, Rich. The use of blackmail is another way that politics is stitched up by the hidden hand.
And we saw that in the Franklin scandal. That we're out of time. Look, we'll get back into these issues again, maybe in the new year, maybe not so early in the new year. You've got things going on. I want to thank you for your time, mate. And not just for me, but from the hundreds and hundreds of messages we've got coming in tonight, many of them have said that they want to thank you personally for what you've done. A lot of so-called alternative media people trying to act all big and bad in the last few years, like they're on top of this issue. No, they're not. I said this on Friday night. You've been talking about this for over 25 years. I'm in your debt, mate, and so is everybody else. Thanks very much.
It's a pleasure, Rich. Always a pleasure to talk to you, mate. And I'm so glad for the opportunity to put some pieces together so the picture can be seen. And please, can you get this around anywhere that you can, so that more and more people can at least have the opportunity of hearing what's really going on. Richie Allen.